Thank you very much for doing this, and thanks to your colleagues for making this possible. So you were recently appointed vice president at the Advanced Concepts and Technology for Raytheon Intelligence and Space, which is part of Raytheon Technologies. In the past, you've worked on really fascinating projects, like you spent quite a lot of time at DARPA as the director of the Tactical Technology Office. So really interesting stuff. I'm a big fan. I've seen lots of videos on some of the programs we've been running. And now, because this is relevant now, so I was wondering if you saw the recent crewed flight test a few days ago. I guess that was the result of the DARPA's Airborne Launch Assist Space Access.
Well, the DARPA program, Airborne Launch Assist Space Access, I think it was called ALASA. Yeah, it's one of DARPA's many efforts over the years to work on, you know, advanced propulsion approaches and affordable access to space.
The other project I saw was the one on, it was the DARPA Robotics Challenge, and I saw a couple of videos showcasing the competition. Also, that was amazing. And I've seen there has been a huge evolution in the robots. I mean, if you consider, for example, Atlas, it started being with those hooks and things and cables, and then there was a video last year where it was doing jumps and really crazy stuff. So are these robots ready to be deployed for applications, or they are still too loud or too bulky to be used for real applications? What's the situation now?
Well, I think there's two or three things you could consider there. One is the development of the robotics capability. It's going to be fundamentally enhanced by, you know, power capabilities, because these systems are all limited by power. We humans, we are, you know, a marvel of biomechanics and the integration of, you know, biological energy into, you know, muscles and tissue and all the rest. So the robotic systems are going to be limited for now in terms of their power capability. That is the fundamental limit. In terms of autonomy and in terms of the connection of them to humans and human-machine teaming, that's coming along, you know, quite well. You brought up the robotics challenge. I would say that over the last 21 years, DARPA and others have worked on, you know, robotics challenges of various forms, whether it was the Grand Challenge or the Robotics Challenge. There was the Red Balloon Challenge, which was about sharing of information. But, you know, all these challenges were meant to inspire and innovate and get the next step going forward in certain areas. And I think the robotics challenge that you talked about was focused on bipeds. It was focused on disaster relief. And there's a lot of progress made in there. I know that. During the run-up of the DRC, the DARPA Robotics Challenge, I was afforded the opportunity to go over to Japan and see Fukushima, where many of the tasks for the DRC were established as a result of considering how could humans employ robots in disaster relief situations. So I think you'll see it there, but the rest of it's going to be quite a bit of human, you know, man-on-man teaming, human-machine teaming for the foreseeable future. And many of these systems are simply going to be limited by the power in the mechanics of them for some period of time.
So they're not ready to be deployed in warfare scenarios yet. We're not going to see any Terminator anytime soon, right?
I don't believe so. And I can't speak for all countries, but I can say, at least within the United States, the sense I'm getting is that we have a strong sense of ethics of how we employ autonomous systems in support of our warfighters. And for the foreseeable future, they're going to be involved in teamed operations only.
I was searching a little bit, and I saw that you worked a long time ago. You worked on gallium arsenide photodetectors during and after your PhD in electrical engineering at Rochester. So what kind of impact did the background in electronics and nuclear engineering have on your career?
Well, nuclear engineering was way back when, so that was my undergraduate degree. It was insightful to teach me all about thermodynamics and nuclear reactor theory, large structures. When I went to graduate school for electrical engineering, my dissertation was on what's called 3-5 semiconductors. It's a class of semiconductors. I worked on indium gallium arsenide, and I was basically doing applied physics, trying to understand the carrier dynamics of that particular material, which is used today in photodetectors and high-speed electronics. The real essence, though, of what I achieved from that or learned from that was that research and pioneering something is a very difficult process. There's a lot of trial and error. You have to have perseverance. Some of the results or the ideas you have coming into pioneering research isn't necessarily the way it comes out. And that's kind of what I learned from all that, was just the difficulty of advanced research And you have to be prepared to stick with it for the long term and persevere through tough challenges.
And so Raytheon is one of the largest aerospace intelligence service providers and service manufacturers in the world. I mean, you joined the company in late 2019. How would you describe Raytheon and what's Raytheon for you? How do you see the company?
Yeah, well, Raytheon today is a very large aerospace commercial and defense company. I think we're about 180,000 people. There's four major businesses, of which I'm part of one. The four major businesses are Raytheon Intelligence and Space, Raytheon Missile Defense, Collins Aerospace, and Pratt & Whitney. On, I think it was April 2020, all four of those businesses came together. That was Heritage Raytheon and Heritage United Technology. It's a really interesting, it's a combination of commercial aerospace and defense. It's got a long history. I think United Technology started back in 1930, I believe. Raytheon started in 1922. Raytheon particularly grew out of essential leadership of Vannevar Bush, who was instrumental in the United States in research development in World War II. United Technology has always been involved in propulsion and power, and Raytheon Technology got it started working on radar systems. So, you know, it's got a long history, and then the merger on April 2020 brings forth these four businesses to really do great things in research and development and science and technology and providing capabilities for, you know, the population and for our warfighters.
Yeah, because you mentioned the history. I mean, Raytheon Technologies was founded in 1922, I believe, and the company evolved from, let's say, manufacturing electrical appliances, and then it became one of the largest players in the defense industry. I mean, what happened there? I mean, when did they decide to change direction? Was it during the Second World War? Or?
Well, they were involved in electronics, but one way to think about Raytheon's early pioneering achievement had to do with, you know, radar systems. You know, the United States and the United Kingdom, during World War II, there was quite a bit of advancement made in early warning radar for detection of aircraft, threatening aircraft. Raytheon was involved in that with the development of microwave tubes and the like. You know, an example of how that defense application migrated into the commercial sector back in the mid-40s was there were some Raytheon engineers after the war that were looking at the microwave tube performance in a laboratory, and one of the scientists, he had a candy bar in his pocket. It was getting hot and starting to melt when he was working with these radar tubes, these microwave tubes. Today, we will use, you know, solid-state power amplifiers, but back in the day, engineers were looking at essentially these electronic tubes to generate the energy to power the radar system. Well, that heating of that candy bar was really the first idea that an engineer had that, hey, we might be able to harness this into some sort of an encased steel cage or electrical cage, and that was the basis of the microwave oven that does use today in kitchens around the world. So it's interesting how defense technology becomes commercial technology, but it all comes from innovation, because who would have known that, you know, a heated up candy bar would become the basis of converting radar technology into something that could be used in the kitchen.
Because we mentioned DARPA, people are probably familiar with DARPA. It's a public organization, but they're also familiar with the Skunk Works, which is from Lockheed Martin, which is a private organization, when it comes to advanced military technology. But I guess Raytheon Advanced Concepts and Technology, the ACT unit, is a relatively new entry in this space. So can you provide some background on the ACT unit? How old is it? What's the story behind it? And why was it established?
Yes, ACT began as a part of the business of Raytheon in 2007. And it was stood up essentially to focus on prototyping capabilities, largely under sponsorship from DARPA and IARPA and the U.S. Air Force, organizations like that. But it was stood up in order to explore the bounds of sensors and subsystems, radars, electro-optical instruments, infrared instruments, manned-unmanned teaming, cyber, things like that. And it was stood up in 2007 to focus on those early customers that are focused on solving hard technical problems. So the way to think about it, and I relay this back to, you know, what I learned in my graduate schooling, was you have to persevere through successes and failures in research and development, because the path is not always linear. ACT was stood up to focus on prototyping those systems, what's called 6-1 to 6-3 funding, or the prototype funding for the U.S. military and for our warfighters.
What's 6-1 to 6-3? What's that?
Yeah, 6-1 is what I would call, it's a category funding they have in the United States. 6-1 funding is what we call basic research. If the U.S. government is going to fund somebody to do the most basic research, the most exploratory, the most nascent. That's what they call 6.1. And then when you get into what's called 6.2 and 6.3, you're starting to take those technologies and combine them together to develop a new prototype and to wring it out and to see if it's going to work. Within the U.S. military establishment, 6.1 to 6.3 funding is often done well before a requirement is even established, because it's not clear that the U.S. military is going to establish a requirement for anything until they know the technology fundamentally works. And so ACT's job is to help prove that point. Sometimes we succeed, sometimes we fail, but either way, we're going to persevere through that challenge and try and solve that prototype for Raytheon and for the warfighter.
That links a little bit to the concept of high payoff and high risk. Does that apply to ACT as it applies to DARPA, or there's a slightly different mindset because this is a private company?
Absolutely the same. It's a great term, high payoff, high risk. A lot of people would like to say, well, it's high risk, high payoff. The point is, we're after the maximum payoff we can get in the development of new technology or a prototype. We accept the risk that goes along with it, and we understand that our goal is to be successful, but sometimes we will not be, and so we go on to the next challenge. But you're absolutely right. It's the highest payoff we can get, and then we'll accept the risk along the way. And that's fundamentally what goes on in what I said 6.1 to 6.3 research. Once you start getting into 6.4 full-blown prototypes or experimentation in the field with the U.S. military, you know, with a warfighter, at that point, the risk has been reduced substantially. And it's then about experimenting with the concepts to make sure that the military understands them. And then they can derive a formal requirement from that, having the confidence that, in this case, Raytheon can deliver the systems needed.
Probably the recent papers that were published in collaboration with Raytheon are part of this type of research, right? So there were some high-profile publications that Raytheon published in Nature and Science in collaboration with the groups worldwide, top groups in Spain, Korea, Japan, and so on. So there was one publication in Nature called Graphene-Based Joseph Junction Microwave Bolometer that details a bolometer that is 100,000 times more sensitive than the current commercial sensors. Can you tell me a little bit about that work? What was that about?
Absolutely. That is what I would call 6.1 or fundamental research.
Okay.
And that particular research was attempted in order to validate an extremely sensitive infrared detector. You called it out correctly. It's called a microwave bolometer. And in this particular case, one of the researchers in ACT, I think partnered up with MIT, developed essentially a single layer of graphite. We call it a graphene detector in between two niobium electrodes on what's called a Josephson junction. And that particular detector is, as you said, extremely sensitive for microwave infrared radiation. We've already sold one of those sensors to a university in Germany that's using it for dark matter detection in deep space. But that's an example of where some researchers attempted something for the first time to see how well that detector would work. That is 6.1 research, and we're going to carry it forward and see what other system and prototype applications that we can achieve with that.
Yeah, because, I mean, bolometers are used in astronomy, and So do you think it's an issue the fact that detectors need to operate at very low temperatures, so near zero Kelvin?
When those detectors are operating at those extremely low temperatures, what's called the noise floor drops and the sensitivity gets much, much better. And that was one of the reasons it was attempted with graphene. You know, graphene as a material is something that's being worked over the last 5 to 10 years. But what's novel here is the fact that it was, you know, embedded in between two niobium junctions in an extremely sensitive framework that could be used for deep space astronomy, or it can be used for switching and potentially quantum computers. There's a variety of applications that we see it can be employed in. But in this particular case, the first implementation is for dark matter detection and for essentially extremely sensitive infrared astronomy.
I know, because you mentioned that they are very small, then it's going to be easier to assemble them into an array, into a matrix, to build up a full-size detector of, for imaging purposes.
Those are the next sets of applications we're looking at with that particular technology, is how do I scale it up with many detectors? In the case of quantum computing, if I want to use them as an extremely sensitive photon detector inside of a quantum computer in a very cold chamber, how can I scale up with those as well? But the first step along the way, in terms of this high payoff, high risk approach, the first step along the way was to validate that the single detectors work extremely effectively by themselves. And that's what we've done.
So you guys work a lot with the universities, and I guess you do lots of partnerships with universities. Do you have any research grants available for scientists where they can go and apply? Is there anything like that?
We do, well, across Raytheon Intelligence Space, number one, we work with a lot of universities on joint proposals. We do a lot of work from the standpoint of internships across Raytheon Intelligence Space. Frankly, it's one way that we're able to find great young talent to join Raytheon Intelligence Space is by the collaborative work and the internships we do with universities. In terms of specific grants, I know universities will pursue specific grants on their own. Raytheon Intelligence Space, ACT, most of our work is what I call CRAD. We do a lot of work with universities in that where we'll be on the receiving end of CRAD funding from the U.S. government, and then, you know, we'll have grants or some sort of fixed price work that we'll do with universities. But I know particularly on the 6-1 and 6-2 work across advanced concepts and technology, we do a lot of work with U.S. universities today, and it's a key part of some of the advancements we make, and it's also a key part of our, you know, recruiting good talent for the future. That's a critical part of the technology ecosystem.
Now, in terms of quantum computing, I believe you're working on quantum computers as well. Have you built one at Raytheon?
Yeah, so ACT is working on what I would call is the systems engineering of quantum computing. And what I mean by that is there's a substantial amount of money in the United States and around the world being dedicated into large, what I'll call large number of qubits. The qubit is a quantum bit. Large number of qubits for scaling up quantum computers and applications, commercial and otherwise. In the particular case of ACT and Raytheon Intelligence Space, we're focused on the system engineering applications to understand the algorithms, to understand the applications such as optimization of aerospace structures and systems. And we're focused on understanding the system engineering and the noise floor limits of the quantum computers. It's one thing to simply say, well, I can build a quantum computer with 50 or 100 qubits. The real question is, can I build them and understand what their performance is, what their noise floor is, how well they perform with error correction and with error rates and understanding it. It's simply not enough to just have a large number of qubits in operation. You have to understand from a system engineering framework how they work in not just in theory, but in operation in order to know what are the potential applications we can really use them in. And so advanced concepts and technology, we're focused on that system engineering question.
So what can be done right now with quantum computers at the moment?
They're still in the research stage. There are many press releases every year that come out about, well, we have 20 qubits or 30 or 40. We've scaled all these up. I think most people understand that in the near term, the applications for quantum computers are in signal processing and optimization problems. And what I mean by that is when I want to scale up and do a large number of qubits in parallel, and I understand how to characterize each one of them, then I can solve signal processing or mathematical problems we call optimization, which are problems in which I need to scale a number of parameters in parallel and process them and then come out with a solution. That's fundamentally different than our canonical pipeline processors that we have in large scale today. So we think those are the near-term applications. Longer term, there's obviously desires to use quantum computers from the standpoint of encryption, understanding encryption and what the fundamental limits are. There's something called Shor's algorithm. It was done many years ago, which postulated that a highly performing quantum computer would be able to break even the most demanding encryption. So we do see those and those potential applications coming down the pike. But today what we're focused on is two things. Number one, the system engineering question, understanding exactly how well they work, what the noise sources are and how to characterize them. And the near-term applications we see are in mathematical optimization.
Now, in terms of, let's change a little bit topic. I wanted to ask, in terms of international business, I would imagine that you're only allowed to sell non-state-of-the-art technology outside the USA. I mean, I would imagine the USA would keep the most advanced devices and things. So if you want to sell something overseas, do you need approval from the U.S. government for each contract you might need to sign? What are you allowed to sell overseas?
You know, Raytheon Intelligence Space is obviously a U.S.-based defense contractor, commercial and aerospace and defense. and we develop quite a bit of advanced technology. From a business standpoint and from a United States government regulation standpoint, we do carefully evaluate and adhere to regulations in terms of what we're able to sell internationally. It's not that we are desire not to, but from a business standpoint and from a proper regulation standpoint, we adhere to all the regulations as we're supposed to. There's ITAR rules and EAR rules, but between both of those, we carefully follow those rules. Having said that, there are systems that we have sold internationally, and we do, you know, every year. One example of what ACT has sold internationally was there was a counter sniper shot detection system that was prototyped and developed by Advanced Concepts and Technology back in the early 2000s. And then at the time, it was developed and sold by BBN, which is a part of ACT today. Those systems were provided to U.S. warfighters, you know, in the 2005-2006 timeframe is when they started to be fielded. And they're sold internationally today in full authorization with ITAR and EAR regulations. So, no, in fact, we do sell internationally, but we're going to properly follow the U.S. regulations and laws as we do so.
What's your approach towards preventing reverse engineering? Because, I mean, software can be reverse engineered. You just need to, you know, disassemble it and then reassemble it. Hardware can be reverse engineered. It's tougher. It's difficult to disassemble a microprocessor and a chip. But larger parts like aircrafts and other things are probably easier to reverse engineer as long as you can maybe replicate what was done with the materials. But how do you protect your systems from being reverse engineered?
An active area of research that we are involved in is trusted computing, trusted distributed systems, and how you do that. The United States government is interested in, you know, in having microelectronic systems that are trusted so that when we provide them to the warfighters for operational systems that they have the utmost confidence that they can trust those systems. And that's an active area of research that we're working on today. I know the United States government has funded different institutions. Raytheon's involved in that. And that is the way I would answer that question, is that we're focused on trusted systems in operation.
I don't know, maybe this is a silly question, but let's say that you are flying some drone in the air, in the sky, and that the drone falls in some country, in some area with the insurgents. Do you have any mechanism to, like, destroy it so that nobody can go and check what's going on there?
Well, I'm not going to speculate on that. I think the question you bring up is something that's in the nature of operational military units. Certainly, any military equipment, when it's employed in an operation, there's a risk that it's going to fall into the hands of the threat. And that's something that the U.S. military will consider in the course of their operations. From a technology standpoint, yeah, we'll do everything we can to develop systems that are trusted so that if those sorts of situations do happen, that we'll have procedures in place to consider how those systems are protected in the future.
Now, talking about the war fighting and strategy, I mean, I saw your 2016 plenary talk at Spy Defense, where you spoke about advanced platforms for sensing in the air, in space, sea, undersea, and the ground domains. So my understanding is that Joint All Domain Command and Control, or JADC2, is a DoD initiative to connect networks from different domains into a single network to enable faster decisions and actions. So in a sense, it's like speed is the best weapon, probably. So what's the role played by Raytheon in the JADC2?
Let me start by highlighting that the JADC2 is one element under a U.S. military doctrine. I believe that the vice chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff highlighted recently, I think it was General Hyten, highlighted Joint All Domain Operations, so JADO. Joint All Domain Command and Control is a piece of the implementation under that doctrine. I know there's ABMS, Advanced Battle Management System, there's Project Convergence, Project Overmatch. Those are all pieces underneath Joint All Domain Operations. Within Joint All Domain Command and Control, one thing that ACT, Raytheon Intelligence Space, is working on is advanced software that can be an enabler. So there's two specific elements that we're working on. You know, one is software and one is communications. And I would phrase these as enablers for JADC2. In the case of software, we have a piece of software we've developed called ARAKNID, which is essentially software that enables multiple units in a warfighting domain to bid and subscribe to the resources available to conduct combat operations. So, you know, one of the most difficult challenges in JADC2 is how do you allocate the resources available, the sensors, the platforms, how do you allocate those to support the mission, given that the mission is always dynamic, it's always changing in real time. You may have an operation or an operation order at the start of the conflict, you begin, but then very quickly, the situation changes. And so within those changing situations, a piece of software that ACT is providing to the military in experimentation, we'll see how they ultimately acquire it. But under experimentation, what we're validating with the ARAKNID software is that you can bid and subscribe in terms of sensor and resource allocation dynamically as the operation unfolds in a very efficient fashion. So that's one piece of JADC2 that we're supporting. Another piece is has to do with communications. In all these operations, you have multiple security levels with multiple military units, with multiple services. They have different protocols. They have different hardware. They have different security levels. And so within that, we've developed software that can be implemented on various radio systems. We call it DyNAMO. And in essence, what it is multi-level, multi-secure mesh networking that can support these dynamic operations in real time. And so the way I would say it is that, you know, both DyNAMO and ARAKNID are currently being used in experimentation today that can support the development of JADC2 in support of joint all-domain operations. We'll see ultimately where the U.S. military goes from an acquisition standpoint, but at least from an experimentation and prototyping standpoint, that's where we're focused today.
So, and basically, this also links to the concept of mosaic warfare. We discussed this concept with Dr. Grayson from DARPA. He spoke about mosaic warfare, and this is part of it, I guess.
Yeah, so DyNAMO and ARAKNID were both funded by the Strategic Technology Office out of DARPA, led by Dr. Tim Grayson. Within the framework of DyNAMO and ARAKNID, indeed, Tim had explained on behalf of DARPA the mosaic warfare construct, which was, you know, you're stitching or you're integrating together different pieces of technology. They weren't necessarily architected up front, but you put them together after the fact in a mosaic-like framework, and I believe that's the way that Dr. Grayson was explaining it.
Is this ARAKNID that you mentioned, the DyNAMO systems, any way related to DARPA's stitches? So DARPA stitches is a way to connect systems that weren't meant to be connected. So it's a sort of middleware.
Yeah, Stitches is a part of one of the programs that was developed out of the Strategic Technology Office, of which ARAKNID is a part. So you're exactly correct. That is a piece of the overall thrust of technology that was being funded by the Strategic Technology Office.
Now, talking about directed energy systems, so these are basically weapons that can hit and damage a target by focusing high energy electromagnetic or sonic wave and even charged particles on it. So the ACT unit developed a system called the High Energy Laser Weapon System, which uses a multispectral targeting system pod to perform surveillance and counter drone attack missions from a lightweight vehicle, basically a dune buggy, a desert car. So what are the components of this system and how does it work?
Yeah, the HELWS system that you referred, it was basically a rapid prototyping effort funded by the U.S. Air Force for advanced concepts and technology to prove in a prototype configuration that a directed energy capability could be put on a small, you call it a dune buggy. It was actually an MRAZR, which is a all-terrain vehicle, I believe, developed by Polaris Corporation. But in this particular case, HELWS was employed in a prototype configuration on an MRAZR to validate that direct energy capability could be used to neutralize small drones on the battlefield. And the way to think about it is you might have a radar system in a tactical situation that could detect these drones or these small quads, which can be threats to, you know, worldwide U.S. military forces and others. And the direct energy capability can be used to neutralize those threats in flight once they've been queued up by a radar system. And the advancement here, these are essentially fiber-coupled systems, solid-state power amplification. So they're, from a power added efficiency standpoint and an employment standpoint, when it's embedded inside of an MTS, a small turret, and put on one of these small all-terrain vehicles, it shows a capability that could be useful to U.S. military in the future when dealing with these small drone threats. The part that I'm proudest about is that, you know, the team from ACT pulled this together in 24 months under Air Force sponsorship, showed what could be done. And now it's up to the U.S. military to decide from a requirement and an acquisition standpoint what they want to do next. But at least from the standpoint of taking the technical question off the table, we show that this can be done.
And so this was adapted from the system that was mounted on the Reaper drone, right?
Yeah, so the MTS platform, the MTS ball turret, which is used for electro-optical and infrared sensors, has been put on a variety of U.S. military aircraft.
So there are two main components. There is the sensing part and there is the laser part that attacks the drones, basically. So in terms of sensing, you have a hyperspectral camera, I guess. I used once a hyperspectral camera. We were looking at some materials. And the thing is that the most surprising thing is that it generates a huge amount of data because you don't just have an image. But for each pixel, you would have a spectrum. So if you have an image like, let's say, 4K images, maybe 25 megabytes, but if you multiply that by the number of vectors that you have in a spectrogram, that becomes like, I don't know, if the vector is 1,000 elements, that becomes 1,000 times larger, so 25 gigabytes. And if you have 30 frames per second, then you get you start getting terabytes. So how do you handle complexity with these systems? And what do you get from different frequencies when you sense?
So if we transition now and talk about just hyperspectral imagery, Raytheon and others obviously have developed hyperspectral instruments in shortwave, midwave, longwave bands. And you're absolutely right. When you use a hyperspectral instrument in a look-down mode from air or other places, you generate what's called a hyperdimensional space. In other words, each of those spectrum that you've divided up from the imaging sensor generates a huge amount of data, whether it's high frame rate or low frame rate, and depending upon the number of spectral channels. And you're absolutely right. That has been one of the, you can call it an opportunity, you can call it a challenge of employing hyperspectral instruments over the last 25 years has been, in fact, the amount of data it generates. But from that data, you can look for match filters, match signatures, you can do atmospheric correction, you can often segment a military target that employs, you know, camouflage, concealment, deception, they call it CCD, from, you know, detect a decoy from a real target. But you're absolutely right. Hyperspectral imagery is a very powerful enabler. It's something that ACT works on.
And what do you get from different frequencies? I mean, are these things probing the infrared up to UV, or maybe what's the range of frequencies they are using?
Yeah, I think you can think of it being used all the way from, you know, 0.4 microns up to 10 or 11 microns, so all the way from the visible near infrared up to the long wave infrared. You know, there's all kinds of different things. You can use it to segment man-made materials from otherwise. You can use it to segment different types of vegetation. In the commercial sector, there's lots of employment of hyperspectral imagery for crop detection to look for healthy crops versus unhealthy crops. Farmers are looking at that. The U.S. military has been interested in looking at long wave signatures for detection of effluents and signatures in that area. There's been some use by the military to look for, you know, camouflage versus non-camouflage targets. There's a whole range of capabilities that can be analyzed from, you know, from the visible all the way to the long wave infrared. But as you said, one of the big challenges coming out of it is just the amount of data it generates is enormous, which I believe is an opportunity.
Yeah. And now talking about the laser system, how long would it take to take down a drone like, Phantom 4, an old Phantom 4, a DJI Phantom 4, or like a drone like this size?
Yeah, I'm not going to get into specifics of the employment, how long it takes. But suffice to say, within that 24-month prototype program, we validated that, you know, in the case of HELWS, a 10-kilowatt system can bring down a quad drone, a small drone. And we validated that within that program.
Have you tried it with the swarm drones?
I'm not going to get into specifics of it. You know, this is something that was funded by the U.S. Air Force so they could evaluate its effectiveness against these emerging classes of threats. But, you know, you can imagine that as these systems proliferate, it's going to be, it's going to be a threat to military forces all over the world.
And also, well, things like stadiums, things like airports. So there are plenty of commercial applications as well.
Yeah, I imagine the commercial sector and the private security business, they're going to be every bit as interested in how they can defend against potential threats from these small drones.
Yeah, and power plants and things like that. And I'm going to ask you something silly. I don't remember, maybe it was 1 year ago or something, there was an incident of the nuclear power plant in Palo Verde that was attacked by, not attacked, but there were drones, and they said those are UFOs. Would you use that system against UFOs or maybe?
Well, I'm not going to speculate on that, but I mean, there's no doubt that small drones have proliferated worldwide. If somebody saw it over Palos Verdes or somebody saw it near a military installation, it's something that I think we've all come to expect based on the fact that they're affordable and they're deployed worldwide. So it's not to me unusual that people are going to find these small drones in places that you probably wouldn't want them. And it's something as a society we're going to have to come to grips with. And, you know, that's why we have regulations. That's why hopefully the FAA is working on those sorts of things. But, you know, from a military standpoint, that's what I'm going to focus on as part of advanced concept and technology is what can we do to defend the warfighter against those potential threats and give them the best chance for success.
Yeah, because, I mean, it was especially, I don't remember where it was. Maybe it was in somewhere in the Middle East they were keeping these drones with explosives and then they were launching them. Commercial drones, I mean, you just mount some explosive and then you send them to targets and civilians, and so it's...
I was going to say, that is exactly, you know, you just pointed out the prime example of why it's of concern to the U.S. military,
yeah.
Because if we're interested in protecting our warfighters or peacekeepers in harm's way, then we've got to give them the best capabilities to defend against the threat. And you're right, the proliferation of those lower-cost systems, you know, even though the payload is not that great, it's enough that it can provide a threat with a capability against U.S. military. So that's why we're interested in this direct energy capability that could be put onto a small all-terrain vehicle with forward-deployed forces to protect themselves. One of the reasons that we were interested in this 24-month prototype effort was that directed energy capability provides, quote-unquote, an unlimited magazine. If I had to use a bullet or some sort of projectile to try and bring down that small drone, I've got to worry about, number one, where do those projectiles, how do I logistically provide them? Depending upon my accuracy, can I actually hit the threat system for anything that I miss? Where do those projectiles come down? And having a directed energy capability provides notionally an unlimited magazine to deal with these lower cost threats.
So you don't need to reload the laser system. As long as you have power, you can still send pulses and pulses and pulses.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
So now switching field a little bit, talking about systems engineering. So this is an interdisciplinary field of engineering and engineering management that focuses on how to design, integrate, and manage systems over their life cycles. But these concepts have been around since many years. But maybe what was missing was computational power, able to support complex simulations and maybe usable digital twins. So what's this digital engineering and how was it used to speed up the design and prototyping of things like, for example, sixth generation fighter jets or other systems?
From a sixth generation sensor standpoint, we are using the digital engineering thread to validate the entire prototype development of a sensor from concept formulation all the way to the final testing. As opposed to thinking only about digital prototype from the standpoint of computer-aided design of a mechanical system, the digital engineering thread means you record and you digitize everything in the process along the way from the standpoint of initial concept formulation to the software development to the actual mechanical hardware to the supply chain. All of that gets digitized as a portion of the record of the development of the capability. And it's done for two main reasons. One is, you know, from the standpoint of prototype formulation, it minimizes the number of mistakes and iterations that you have to do because you got a good digital record right off the bat. And then the second aspect is once you complete the prototype project successfully, for example, that high-energy laser weapon system, we've got a full digital record now so that if another part of Raytheon is going to go in and produce the system in response to the U.S. military saying, hey, we want to acquire multiples of those, not just that first prototype, then we've got a complete digital archive of the entire system and the process by which we use to develop it that enables the production to be just much better. But from a sensor standpoint, it means that the number of iterations in the design cycle, you can actually do more iterations digitally.
Mm.
If I had to do all that in an analog framework with teams of people developing a new sensor, developing a new concept, if I'm going to use, you know, evolution from the multispectral targeting system you're talking about, I don't. But if I use something like that, if I do that analog, I will have to use engineering teams multiple times to cycle through the design. Once I do it digitally, I can do it much more rapidly and much more accurately. So then once I finally bend metal the first time, then the odds that I'm going to get it right the first time are much higher. And that's another reason to do the digital thread, is it just allows me to cycle through the design process much more rapidly. Within the software framework, there's a term within agile software development called continuous integration and test. And what that means is, once I've developed some software within the digital thread that might be used for these sixth-gen sensor programs, once I go into a testing framework 10, 15 years ago, I might have to have a software developer spend day and night pressing, you know, the return button to keep running the software to validate whether it works or not. In a digital thread, that continuous integration and test, that regression testing, as we call it, is done automated, and it can run 24/7 without any humans at all. That entire process means I'll reduce the number of errors, I'll find my bugs faster, and that just speeds up the accuracy and the performance of the entire system in a much better way.
So this is hardware development that is taking suggestions from the best practices from software development, basically.
Oh, absolutely. The agile software development cycle predated the digital thread by probably 10 years. And that was really a recognition, you know, the agile software development cycle came out of the commercial industry, and now it's gone into the defense industry, and we're gradually shifting, you know, our programs to be, you know, agile DevOps. And within ACT, we're threading that now to be as well our hardware development programs. That's one way we're leading the way for RINS.
Would you be able to explain what's agile programming and development for the audience? Because that's very important.
Absolutely. Yeah. So agile software development is fundamentally a construct where the metric, the evaluation metric for software development, is fundamentally a unit of time. And what it means by that is I'll set up a particular thread, or a sprint is typically what it's called, a 30-day sprint you might have. But within that 30-day sprint of software development, you'll have a set of stories or touch points from a software development standpoint, and you'll iterate them very rapidly within a period of time, so that over a 30-year period, you may cycle through three or four elements of software development. In the older type approach, what was called waterfall, you'll set up a whole set of requirements, and then you'll lay out an 18-month plan to accomplish it, and then you'll work like crazy to accomplish all those goals. And in many cases, you'll be successful. But the commercial world 15 years ago identified that if the unit of measure within software development was focused on time, that they could adopt a more agile approach that was efficient in the employment of the use, you know, per hour of a software developer. And so in that particular case, software led the way, and now hardware is folding in nicely, working on developing hardware in an agile framework, which is exactly what the digital engineering thread is.
Talking about sensors and transmission, transmitters and receivers, there was an article that said that Raytheon unit wins DARPA millimeter wave digital array phase 2 contract. So my understanding is that there is an interest in developing more capabilities in terms of millimeter wave communication between different units, because essentially the radio frequency spectrum is very crowded. Can you explain what's the situation? Why is it crowded, and why there is a need to move to, let's say, 5G bands?
Millimeter wave is of utility to the U.S. military, because as you go higher in frequency, if you go from, you know, S-band up to X-band, and then you go up to Ka and beyond, you know, 35 gigahertz and beyond, as long as I maintain an effective fractional bandwidth, I have more capabilities because of the directionality and the total bandwidth capability within that frequency range. Now, as you go higher and higher in frequency, you have water vapor, and so you have atmospheric attenuation that kicks in. But nonetheless, the U.S. military in many ways is migrating capabilities up into the millimeter wave. So that's one reason that Raytheon, within the MIDAS program, we're pursuing it. But let me take a step back for a second. You know, Raytheon Technologies has been working on radio frequency systems for many years. And for many years, those systems were segmented. So on an aircraft, you might have a communication subsystem, and then you might have an electronic attack subsystem, and then you might have a radar subsystem. But those were all three different systems. In the MIDAS program, what we're validating is that I can combine all three of those together into what's called a multifunction system. And the U.S. military ultimately wants that, because they'd like to have one aperture on a notional aircraft that has all those functions combined together, because from a real estate perspective on that vehicle, I combined it all into one piece of real estate, which is very valuable for the U.S. military, the real estate on these platforms. So developing a multifunction system in the millimeter wave is extremely capable and extremely effective, the U.S. military, and that's what the MIDAS program is all about, showing that within the millimeter wave frequency, I can do radar, EA, and comms all out of the same aperture, all in a way that's highly directional as a function of essentially a phased array. And so within the program, we're developing all the subsystems, the TR modules, how you do the three-dimensional stacking. It's all a very demanding technical application. Referring back to what I said at the start, it's a high-payoff application, not without its risks, but it's a high-payoff application for the U.S. military to develop a millimeter wave multifunction system, and that's what we're pursuing.
So when you work with these frequencies, I don't know exactly what frequencies are you're using, I guess from 30 to 300 gigahertz, that's probably the case, I don't know. But
millimeter wave is, you know, when you're getting up to 300 gigahertz, that's much higher. That's what's called terahertz, you know, sub-terahertz. But, you know, the standard millimeter wave is, I think most people consider it to be in the what's called a Ka band.
And is distance an issue? Because, I mean, if you're working with radio waves, distance is not really an issue. But when you get shorter wavelengths, maybe distance is an issue and you need to increase power. Is there any drawback with these frequencies?
Well, no. I think that from a system engineering and an architecture scaling standpoint, it ends up being what's called a power aperture issue, which is, do I have the aperture necessary within the power and the transmit receive elements in behind to generate the power necessary to accomplish the mission, taking into account the atmospherics? But that's something we account for within the whole system engineering design process. Back to that digital engineering threat. No, that's all accounted for. The reason that you know, it's not just because the radio frequency spectrum is crowded below it, but there's also reasons you want to go higher in frequency because, you know, in some cases, the application gives you more, it gives you better resolution. But, you know, in terms of going higher power and higher frequency, it's more demanding technologically, which is one reason that, you know, Raytheon's being paid to do this in the MIDAS program.
And is there any link with the Starlink constellation, or that's totally unrelated? Because the Starlink is beaming 5G. I don't know if that can be used for communication with your systems or...
Well, that's slightly different, but advanced concepts and technology, we are being paid by the U.S. Air Force on a program called Global Lightning to demonstrate that we can communicate from a U.S. military aircraft to the Starlink constellation. And the way to think about it is there are a variety of what we would call PLEO, or proliferated LEO constellations, Starlink, Telesat, OneWeb, Kuiper. They're all examples of emerging proliferated LEO constellations. And the U.S. military is interested in seeing, can their aircraft communicate directly with these emerging constellations for military purposes. Within the Global Lightning program, we are in fact being paid to validate that we can demonstrate connectivity between a U.S. military aircraft and Starlink. And that program is well underway.
Oh, cool. I didn't know that. Oh. So last thing I want to discuss about was synthetic biology. So you guys are working on synthetic biology according to your website. I mean, it's a big field. I didn't know it existed. I just found out that there is an entire section on the Nature magazine. So synthetic biology is the convergence of biology and computer science, basically. What's the philosophy behind this approach and what projects are you working on right now?
Sure. Well, let me back up for 1 second. Within advanced concepts and technology, you know, we'll work on kind of what I call two different types of technology or categories. We're going to work on things that are just completely disruptive. There's no requirement whatsoever for it. And in other cases, we'll work on emerging areas of technology or maturing or technologies that integrate with in concepts that the U.S. military can already think about, you know. So MIDAS and Global Lightning are examples of things they can already see a path to. Synthetic biology is what I call a disruptive area. There's no requirement yet, and yet, as you pointed out, there is, in fact, a merging of biology and computer science that's unfolded over the last 10 years. And within ACT, we're looking at that area to try and understand what are the U.S. military capabilities that might come out of it. One example is we have a group of scientists that understood that the technologies necessary to conduct deep packet inspection of high data rate networks, that the ability to understand those packets of information, that same algorithmic approach can be used to look through DNA sequences. And so we had a bunch of scientists that said, if I can look at deep packet inspection to understand if there's nefarious cyber traffic on a data rate of a network, could I use that same approach to look for pathogens that somebody might put digitally in the sequence of DNA? And they've been working on that for the last 10 years. And in fact, we've successfully completed that under an IARPA program. And we've been able to complete the licensing of what we call our FastNA algorithm, because there are DNA manufacturers in the United States today, and they'd like to know if somebody gives them a DNA sequence to manufacture the material, they want to make sure nothing pathogenic's in there. They want to make sure nothing nefarious is in there. So they're employing an algorithm that ACT has developed to check the data sequence in the DNA digitally to make sure there's nothing nefarious before they go produce it. So that's one example. Another example of synthetic biology that we're working on is the utilization of essentially sequences of material that will penetrate down into the soil, try and detect if explosive material is below the soil, like an IED, and then it will propagate back up to the surface and fluoresce at the surface so that a warfighter might be able to see, hey, don't go near that region or that area of the ground, there's something underneath it. And we're essentially going to use, you know, propagating algae back to the surface to fluoresce up and give off a light so you can see it. So that's the second example of biology that's being used synthetically. A third example is we have some scientists that are working on a program sponsored out of DARPA to understand if naturally occurring shrimp that actually snap when they snap their claws together, if the sonic signature that they emit underwater can be used as a signal of opportunity to detect maritime threats underwater. So the point is, all three of those, that FastNA algorithm, the explosive detection subsurface, and snapping shrimp, not one of those has a requirement. But all three of those, or any of the three, depending upon if they ultimately turn out to be successful, may be very effective in the merging of biology and engineering and computer science and the U.S. military to provide capabilities. And that's an example of disruptive technology that we'll pursue. And sometimes ACT, we may pursue that for 10 years before we decide whether to stop working on it or to transition it. Because sometimes it takes many years for a disruptive area of technology to really come to fruition.
When it comes to synthetic biology, I mean, there seems to be a convergence between bio-warfare and cyber-warfare. So does it imply that maybe, I don't know, this is a big perspective, maybe the only way to survive bio-warfare is to upgrade humans as if they were machines with the next available antivirus upgrade?
Well, I think the way I would phrase that, Sam, is that we're focused on, in the case of the synthetic biology work that we're doing, we're focused on, you know, in the case of the pathogenic sequences, finding things in the data and taking advantage of the cyber capabilities and the data analytics that we understand to provide, in this particular case, you know, capabilities to find pathogenic sequences in the DNA. From the overall biowarfare standpoint, I'm not going to make a comment on that at all. You know, from an advanced concepts and technology standpoint, in the case of synthetic biology, we're focused on the maturing area of biology and data science and how it can be used in a protective way for our warfighters, and also to understand from a disruptive innovation standpoint where biology is headed as a maturing engineering field. I made the comment earlier about agile and agile operations and DevOps and things like that in the maturation of the software engineering field. And then we're migrating that into our hardware. The same sort of thing is happening in biology. Biology was for a long, long time an analog field where, you know, a scientist or a researcher might work in a laboratory with a beaker and check and experiment one at a time. What we understand now is that, you know, with the rich capabilities of data analytics, that we can start to bring that maturing field of data analytics into biology and help make advances that might be beneficial for our warfighters from a defensive standpoint.
Yeah. All right, thank you very much. I think we can close it here unless we want to add some other points. Would you like to add anything else to this discussion.
First off, I want to thank you for your time today, Sam, but I just want to reiterate that, the advanced concepts and technology as part of Raytheon Intelligence Space is really excited to be the prototyping arm and to provide capabilities in the disruption and the emerging area of technology that's useful to help pioneer Raytheon's intelligence space going forward.
Okay, thank you very much for your time, and hopefully we can meet when I will be in the U.S.
Yeah, thanks, Sam. I appreciate it. It was really great to spend time with you today and to be able to talk about, advanced concepts and technology as a pioneering and innovator for Raytheon Intelligence Space. Thank you.